The Visitation of the Blessed Virgin Mary. By the words of the heavenly messenger, the Archangel Gabriel, Most Holy Mary had been informed that her cousin Elizabeth, who was held to be sterile, had conceived the son and that she was already in the sixth month of her pregnancy. Afterwards, in one of the intellectual visions, the Most High revealed to her that in the miraculous birth, Elizabeth would bring forth a son, who would be great before the Lord, a prophet and the forerunner of the incarnate Word. Also other great mysteries of the holiness and of the personality of Saint John were revealed to her. On this same occasion and on others the heavenly queen was informed that it would be agreeable and pleasing to the Lord if she would visit her cousin, in order that as well Elizabeth as also the child in her womb might be sanctified by the presence of their Redeemer. For His Majesty was anxious to communicate the benefits of His coming into the world and His merits to His precursor, in order to make of him as it were the well-seasoned first fruit of His redemption. At the news of this sacramental mystery the most prudent virgin, with admirable jubilee of spirit, rendered thanks to the Lord for such great condescension and favor vouchsafed to the soul of the precursor and prophet and to his mother Elizabeth. Signifying her readiness to fulfill the divine pleasure, she spoke to His Majesty and said, Most High Lord, beginning and cause of all good, let thy name be eternally glorified, acknowledged and praised by all the nations. I, the least of thy creatures, give thee humble thanks for the liberal kindness which thou wishest to show to thy servant Elizabeth and to the son of her womb. If it is according to the promptings of thy condescension that I serve thee in this work, I stand prepared, my Lord, to obey eagerly thy divine mandates. The Most High answered her, My dove and my beloved, elect among creatures, truly I say to thee, that on account of thy intercession and thy love I will, as a father and most liberal God, take care of thy cousin Elizabeth and of the son, who is to be born of her. I will choose him as my prophet and as the precursor of the Word, which is made man in thee. I will look upon them as belonging to thee and intimately connected with thyself. Therefore I wish that my and thy only begotten go to see the mother, in order to free the son from the chains of the first sin and in order that, before the common and ordinary time decreed for other men, his voice and praise may sound up to my ears, and that the mysteries of the incarnation and redemption may be revealed to his sanctified soul. Therefore I wish thee to visit Elizabeth. For we three persons of the Blessed Trinity have chosen her son for great deeds conformable to our pleasure. To this command of the Lord the most obedient mother responded, Thou knowest, my Lord and God, that all the desires of my heart seek but thy divine pleasure and that I wish to fulfill diligently whatever thou commandest to thy humble servant. Allow me, my God, to ask permission from my husband Joseph and that I make this journey according to his will and direction. And in order that I may not diverge from what is thy pleasure, do thou govern me during that journey in all my actions, direct my footsteps to the greater glory of thy name. I accept therefore the sacrifice, which I bring in going out in public and in leaving my cherished retirement. I wish to offer more than my desires. God and King of my soul, I hope to be made able to suffer all that will conduce to thy greater service and pleasure purely for thy love, so that the longings of my soul may not remain entirely unfulfilled. When our great queen came out of this vision, she called upon the thousand angels of her guard, who appeared to her in bodily forms, and told them of the command of the Most High. She asked them to assist her with careful solicitude in this journey, to teach her how to fulfill all the commands according to the greater pleasure of the Lord, to defend her and guard her from dangers so that she might conduct herself in all things during that journey in the most perfect manner. The holy princes, with wonderful devotion, offered to obey and serve her. In the same manner the mistress of all prudence and humility was wont to act also on other occasions. For though she was herself more wise and more perfect in her deeds than the angels, yet because she was yet in the state of pilgrimage and endowed with a nature lower than that of the angels, she was always solicitous to attain the plenitude of perfection by consulting and asking for the aid of her guardian angels, though they were her inferiors in sanctity. Under their direction, as also by the promptings of the Holy Spirit, all her human actions were well disposed and well ordered. The heavenly spirits obeyed her with alacrity and punctuality, such as was proper to their nature and due to their queen and lady. They held sweet intercourse and delightful colloquy with her, and alternately with her they sang highest songs of praise and adoration of the Most High. At other times they conversed about the supernal mysteries of the incarnate Word, the hypostatic union, the sacrament of the redemption, the triumphs to be celebrated by him, the fruits and blessings accruing therefrom to mortals. It would necessitate lengthening out this work too much, if I were to write all that has been revealed to me about these conversations. The humble spouse proceeded immediately to ask the consent of Saint Joseph for executing the mandate of the Most High, and, in her consummate prudence, she said nothing of these happenings, but simply spoke to him these words: "My lord and spouse, by the divine light it was made known to me, that through condescension of the Most High the prayer of my cousin Elizabeth, the wife of Zacharias, has been heard. She has conceived the son, though she was sterile. Since she has obtained this singular blessing, I hope that through God's infinite bounty, her son will greatly please and glorify the Lord. I think that on this occasion I am under obligation to visit her and converse with her on certain things for her consolation and spiritual encouragement. If this is according to thy liking, my master, I will perform it with thy permission, for I am entirely subject to thy will and pleasure. Consider then what is best for me and command what I'm to do." This prudent silence of the Most Holy Mary, so full of humble subjection, was very agreeable to the Lord. For she showed herself thereby worthy and capable of receiving the deposit of the great sacraments of the King. Therefore, and on account of the confidence in his fidelity with which he proceeded, His Majesty disposed the most pure heart of Saint Joseph, giving him his divine right to act conformably to his will. This is the reward of the humble, who ask for counsel, that they will find it with certainty and security. It is also the peculiar prerogative of a holy and discreet zeal to be able to give prudent advice to those that ask. Full of this holy counsel, Saint Joseph answered our Queen, "Thou knowest already, my lady and spouse, that my utmost desires are to serve thee with all diligence and attention. For I am bound to have this confidence in thy great virtue, that thou wilt not incline toward anything which is not according to the greater pleasure and glory of the Most High. And this is my belief also in regard to this journey. Lest thy making this journey alone and without the company of thy husband cause surprise, I will gladly go with thee and attend to thy wants on the way. Do thou appoint the day on which we shall depart together." The Most Holy Mary thanked her prudent spouse Joseph for his loving solicitude and for his attentive cooperation with the will of God in whatever he knew to be for his service and honor. They both concluded to depart immediately on their visit to the house of Saint Elizabeth and prepared without delay the provisions, which consisted merely in a little fruit, bread and a few fishes, procured by Saint Joseph. In addition to these he borrowed an humble beast of burden, in order to carry their provisions and his spouse, the Queen of all creation. Forthwith they departed from Nazareth for Judea. The journey itself I will describe in the following chapter. On leaving their poor dwelling, the great mistress of the world knelt at the feet of her spouse Joseph and asked his blessing in order to begin the journey in the name of the Lord. The saint was abashed at the rare humility of his spouse, with which he had already been impressed by experience on so many other occasions. He hesitated giving her his benediction. But the meek and sweet persistence of the Most Holy Mary overcame his objections and he blessed her in the name of the Most High. The Heavenly Lady raised her eyes and her heart to God, in order to direct her first steps toward the fulfillment of the divine pleasure and willingly bearing along in her womb the only begotten of the Father and her own, for the sanctification of John and that of his mother Elizabeth. The journey of the Most Holy Mary on her visit to Saint Elizabeth and her entrance into the house of Zacharias. "And Mary rising up in those days," says the sacred text, "went into the hill country with haste, into a city of Judea." This rising up of our Heavenly Queen signified not only her exterior preparations and setting out from Nazareth on her journey, but it referred to the movement of her spirit and to the divine impulse and command which directed her to arise interiorly from the humble retirement which she had chosen in her humility. She arose as it were from the feet of the Most High, whose will and pleasure she eagerly sought to fulfill, like the lowliest handmaid, who according to the word of David keeps her eyes fixed upon the hands of her mistress, awaiting her commands. Arising at the bidding of the Lord, she lovingly hastened to accomplish His most holy will, in procuring without delay the sanctification of the precursor of the incarnate Word, who was yet held prisoner in the womb of Elizabeth by the bonds of original sin. This was the purpose and object of this journey. Therefore the Princess of Heaven arose and proceeded in diligent haste, as mentioned by the evangelist Saint Luke. Leaving behind then the house of her father and forgetting her people, the most chaste spouses, Mary and Joseph, pursued their way to the house of Zacharias in mountainous Judea. It was 26 leagues distant from Nazareth, and the greater part of the way was very rough and broken, unfit for such a delicate and tender maiden. All the convenience at their disposal for the arduous undertaking was an humble beast, on which she began and pursued her journey. Although it was intended solely for her comfort and service, yet Mary, the most humble and unpretentious of all creatures, many times dismounted and asked her spouse Saint Joseph to share with her this commodity and to lighten the difficulties of the way by making use of the beast. Her discreet spouse never accepted this offer, and in order to yield somewhat to the solicitations of the heavenly lady, he permitted her now and then to walk with him part of the way, whenever it seemed to him that her delicate strength could sustain the exertion without too great fatigue. But soon he would again ask her, with great modesty and reverence, to accept of this slight alleviation, and the celestial queen would then obey and again proceed on her way seated in the saddle. Thus alleviating their fatigue by humble and courteous contentions, the Most Holy Mary and Saint Joseph continued on their journey, making good use of each single moment. They proceeded alone, without accompaniment of any human creatures. But all the thousand angels, which were set to guard the couch of Solomon, the Most Holy Mary, attended upon them. Although the angels accompanied them in corporeal form, serving their great queen and her most holy son in her womb, they were visible only to Mary. In the company of the angels and of Saint Joseph, the Mother of Grace journeyed along, filling the fields and the mountains with the sweetest fragrance of her presence and with the divine praises, in which she unceasingly occupied herself. Sometimes she conversed with the angels and, alternately with them, sang divine canticles concerning the different mysteries of the divinity and the works of creation and of the incarnation. Thus ever anew the pure heart of the Immaculate Lady was inflamed by the ardors of divine love. In all this her spouse Saint Joseph contributed his share by maintaining a discreet silence, and by allowing his beloved spouse to pursue the flights of her spirit. For, lost in highest contemplation, he was favored with some understanding of what was passing within her soul. At other times the two would converse with each other and speak about the salvation of souls and the mercies of the Lord, of the coming of the Redeemer, of the prophecies given to the ancient fathers concerning him, and of other mysteries and sacraments of the Most High. Something happened on the way, which caused great wonder in her holy spouse Joseph. He loved his spouse most tenderly with a chaste and holy love, such as had been ordained in him by the special grace and dispensation of the divine love itself. In addition to this privilege, which was certainly not a small one, the saint was naturally of the most noble and courteous disposition, and his manners were most pleasing and charming. All this produced in him a most discreet and loving solicitude, which was yet increased by the great holiness, which he had seen from the beginning in his spouse and which was ordained by heaven as the immediate object of all his privileges. Therefore the saint anxiously attended upon Most Holy Mary and asked her many times, whether she was tired or fatigued, and in what he could serve her on the journey. But as the Queen of Heaven already carried within the virginal chamber the divine fire of the incarnate Word, Holy Joseph, without fathoming the real cause, experienced in his soul new reactions, proceeding from the words and conversations of his beloved spouse. He felt himself so inflamed by divine love and imbued with such exalted knowledge of the mysteries touched upon in their conversations, that he was entirely renewed and spiritualized by this burning interior light. The farther they proceeded and the more they conversed about these heavenly things, so much the stronger these affections grew, and he became aware that it was the words of his spouse, which thus filled his heart with love and inflamed his will with divine ardor. So great were these new sensations, that the prudent Joseph could not help but pay the greatest attention to them. Although he knew that all this came to him through the mediation of Most Holy Mary, and although it was a wonderful consolation to him that she was the cause, he meditated upon it without curiosity, and, on account of his great modesty, he did not dare to ask her any questions. The Lord having ordained it thus, for it was not yet time, that he should know the sacrament of the King, which was already completed in her virginal womb. The heavenly princess beheld the interior of her spouse, knowing all that passed within his soul, and in her prudence she reflected how it would naturally be unavoidable that he should come to know of her pregnancy. For there would be no possibility of concealing it from her most beloved and chaste spouse. The great lady did not know at the time how God would arrange this matter. Yet, although she had not received any intimation or command to conceal this mystery, her heavenly prudence and discretion taught her that it would be proper to conceal it as a great sacrament, greater than all other mysteries. Therefore she kept it secret, saying not a word about it to her husband, neither after the message of the angel, nor during this journey, nor later on, during the anxiety's occasion to Saint Joseph at becoming aware of her pregnancy. O admirable discretion and prudence more than human! The great queen resigned herself entirely to the divine providence, hoping that God would arrange all things. Yet she felt anxiety and pain at the thought of what her husband might think, and of her inability to do anything in order to dissipate his anxiety. This anxiety was increased by the attentive care and service lavished by him upon her with so much love and affection. Since his faithful services certainly deserved a corresponding return on her part as far as was prudently possible. Therefore, in loving solicitude and in pursuance of her desires to solve this coming difficulty, she prayed to the Lord, asking him to grant his divine assistance and guidance to Saint Joseph, when it should arrive. In this state of suspense, in which she found herself, Her Highness performed great and heroic acts of faith, hope and charity, of prudence, humility, patience and fortitude, imbuing all her activity with the plenitude of holiness and reaching in all things the summit of perfection. This journey was the first pilgrimage begun by the Divine Word, 4 days after he had entered the world. For his most ardent love would not suffer any longer delay or procrastination in enkindling the fire, which he came to scatter in the world, and in beginning his justification of mortals with his precursor. This haste he communicated also to his Holy Mother, in order that she might arise without delay and fly on her visit to Elizabeth. The Most Heavenly Lady on this occasion served as a coach of the true Solomon, but much more richly adorned and more elegant, as Solomon himself infers in the Canticles. Therefore this journey was glorious and occasioned great joy to the only begotten of the Father. For he travelled at his ease in the virginal chamber of his mother, enjoying the sweet tokens of her love. At the time she alone was the archive of this treasure, the secretary of so great a sacrament, and she adored him, blessed and admired him, spoke and listened to him, and answered him. She reverenced him and thanked him for herself and for all the human race, much more than all the men and the angels together. In the course of the journey, which lasted 4 days, the two holy pilgrims, Mary and Joseph, exercised not only the virtues which were interior and had God for their immediate object, but also many other outward acts of charity toward their neighbors. For Mary could not remain idle at the sight of want. They did not find the same hospitable treatment at all the inns of the road. For some of the innkeepers, being more rude, treated them with slight consideration in accordance with their natural disposition. Others received them with true love inspired by divine grace. But the Mother of Mercy denied to no one such help as she could administer. And therefore, whenever she could decently do so, she hastened to visit and hunt up the poor, infirm and afflicted, helping them and consoling them, and curing their sicknesses. I will not stop to relate all that happened on the way, but will only mention the good fortune of the poor sick girl, whom our great queen found in passing through a town on the first day of her journey. She was moved to tenderest compassion at the sight of her grievous illness. And, making use of her power as mistress of the creatures, she commanded the fever to leave the maiden and the humors to recompose and reduce themselves to their natural state and condition. At this command and at the sweet presence of the purest mother, the sick maiden was suddenly freed and healed from her pains of body and benefited in soul, so that afterwards she lived more and more perfectly and attained the state of sanctity. For the image of the authoress of her happiness remained stamped within her memory and her heart was enkindled with a great love toward the heavenly lady, although she never again saw her, nor was the miracle ever made public. Having pursued their journey 4 days, the Most Holy Mary and her spouse arrived at the towns of Judah, where Zachary and Elizabeth then lived. This was the special and proper name of the place, where the parents of Saint John lived for a while, and therefore the evangelist Saint Luke specifies it, calling it Judah, although the commentators have commonly believed that this was not the name of the town in which Elizabeth and Zacharias lived, but simply the name of the province, which was called Judah or Judo. Just as for the same reason the mountains south of Jerusalem were called the mountains of Judah. But it was expressly revealed to me that the town was called Judah and that the evangelist calls it by its proper name. Although the learned expositors have understood by this name of Judah the province, in which that town was situated. This confusion arose from the fact that some years after the death of Christ the town Judah was destroyed, and, as the commentators found no trace of such a town, they inferred that Saint Luke meant the province and not a town. Thus the great differences of opinion and regard to the place, where Most Holy Mary visited Elizabeth, are easily explained. as holy obedience has enjoined upon me the duty of clearing up these doubts, on account of the strange inconsistency in the sayings of learned men, I will also add to what I have already said, that the house in which the visitation took place was built upon the very spot on which now the faithful pilgrims, who travel to or live in the Holy Land, venerate the divine mysteries transacted during the visit. Although the town of Judah itself, where the house of Zacharias stood, is ruined, the Lord did not permit the memory of the venerable locality in which those great mysteries transpired, and which were hallowed by the footsteps of Most Holy Mary, of Christ our Lord, and of the Baptist as well as of his holy parents, to be blotted out and effaced from the memory of men. Therefore it was by divine influence that the ancient Christians built up those churches and restored the holy places, in order to preserve by the agency of divine light the traditional truth and to renew the memory of the admirable sacraments. Thus we ourselves, the faithful of our times, can enjoy the blessing of venerating and worshipping the sacred localities, proclaiming and confessing our Catholic faith in the works of our redemption. For the better understanding of these things, let it be remembered that after the demon had become aware on Calvary that Christ our Lord was God and the Redeemer of men, he sought with incredible fury to blot out the remembrance of him from the land of the living, as Jeremias says. And the same is to be said of the memory of his Most Holy Mother. Thus he managed to have the Most Holy Cross hidden and buried underground, and to have it delivered as spoil of war to the Persians. And in the same way he procured the ruin and obliteration of many holy places. On this account the holy angels carried back and forth so many times the venerable and holy house of Loreto. For the same dragon who pursued the heavenly lady had already excited the minds of the inhabitants of that land to tear down and raise to the ground that most sacred oratory, which had been the workshop of the Most High in the mystery of the Incarnation. The same astute hatred of the enemy urged him to blot out the towns of Judah, aided partly by the negligence of the inhabitants, who gradually died off, partly also by untoward events and happenings. Yet the Lord did not allow all traces of the house of Zachary to be effaced or obliterated, on account of the sacraments, which were there enacted. This town was distant from Nazareth, as I have said, 26 leagues, and about 2 leagues from Jerusalem, and it was situated in that part of the Judean mountains, where the stream Sirek takes its rise. After the birth of Saint John and the return of the Most Holy Mary and her spouse Joseph to Nazareth, Saint Elizabeth received a divine revelation that a great calamity and slaughter impended over the infants of Bethlehem and its vicinity. And though this revelation was indeterminate and unclear, it nevertheless induced the mother of Saint John to betake herself with Zacharias, her husband, to Hebron, which was 8 leagues more or less from Jerusalem. For they were rich and noble, and they had dwellings not only in Judah and Hebron, but they had houses and possessions also in other places. When the Most Holy Mary and Joseph were on their way flying from Hero to Egypt after the birth of the Word and some months after the birth of Saint John, Saint Elizabeth and Zacharias were in Hebron. Zacharias died 4 months after our Lord was born, which was 10 months after the birth of his son John. It seems to me I have now sufficiently solved this doubt, and it ought to be evident that the house of the Visitation was neither in Jerusalem, nor in Bethlehem, nor in Hebron, but in the town called Judah. I saw that this is the true explanation, which was made known to me by divine light together with the other mysteries of this heavenly history. Afterwards, when I was constrained by obedience to ask about this matter, a holy angel again made the same declaration to me. It was at this city of Judah and at the house of Zacharias that Most Holy Mary and Joseph arrived. In order to announce their visit, Saint Joseph hastened ahead of Mary and calling out saluted the inmates of the house, saying, "The Lord be with you and fill your souls with divine grace." Elizabeth was already forewarned, for the Lord himself had informed her in a vision that Mary of Nazareth had departed to visit her. She had also in this vision been made aware that the heavenly lady was most pleasing in the eyes of the Most High. While the mystery of her being the Mother of God was not revealed to her until the moment when they both saluted each other in private. But Saint Elizabeth immediately issued forth with a few of her family, in order to welcome Most Holy Mary, who, as the more humble and younger in years, hastened to salute her cousin, saying, "The Lord be with you, my dearest cousin," and Elizabeth answered, "The same Lord reward you for having come in order to afford me this pleasure." With these words they entered the house of Zacharias, and what happened I will relate in the following chapter. The salutation given to Saint Elizabeth by the Queen of Heaven and the sanctification of John. When the Most Holy Mother Mary arrived at the house of Zacharias, The precursor of Christ had completed the sixth month of his conception in the womb of Saint Elizabeth. The body of the child John had already attained the state of great natural perfection, much greater than that of other children, on account of the miracle of his conception by a sterile mother and on account of the intention of the Most High to make him the depositary of greater sanctity than other men. Yet at that time his soul was yet filled with the darkness of sin, which he had contracted in the same way as the other children of Adam, the first and common father of the human race. And as, according to the universal and general law, mortals cannot receive the light of grace before they have issued forth to the light of the sun, so, after the first, the original sin contracted by our nature, the womb of the mother must serve as a dungeon or prison for all of us, who have laden upon ourselves this guilt of our father and head, Adam. Christ our Lord resolved to anticipate this great blessing in his prophet and precursor by conferring the light of his grace and justification upon him 6 months after his conception by Saint Elizabeth, in order that he might be distinguished as well in holiness, as he was in his office of precursor and Baptist. After the first salutation of Elizabeth by the Most Holy Mary, the two cousins retired, as I have said at the end of the preceding chapter. And immediately the Mother of Grace saluted anew her cousin, saying, May God save thee, my dearest cousin, and may his divine light communicate to thee grace and life. At the sound of Most Holy Mary's voice, Saint Elizabeth was filled by the Holy Ghost and so enlightened interiorly, that in one instant she perceived the most exalted mysteries and sacraments. These emotions, and those that at the same time were felt by the child John in the womb of his mother, were caused by the presence of the Word made flesh in the bridal chamber of Mary's womb, for, making use of the voice of Mary as his instrument, he, as Redeemer, began from that place to use the power given to him by the Eternal Father for the salvation and justification of the souls. And since he now operated as man, though as yet of the diminutive size of one conceived 8 days before, he assumed, in admirable humility, the form and posture of one praying and beseeching the Father. He asked in earnest prayer for the justification of his future precursor and obtained it at the hands of the Blessed Trinity. Saint John was the third one for whom our Redeemer made special petition since his presence in the womb of his mother. His mother was the first for whom he gave thanks and prayed to the Father. Next in order was her spouse, Saint Joseph, for whom the Incarnate Word offered up his prayers, as we have said in the 12th chapter. And the third one was the precursor Saint John, whom the Lord mentioned by name in his prayers to the Father. Such was the great good fortune and privilege of Saint John, that Christ our Lord presented to the Eternal Father the merits of his passion and death to be endured for men. And in view thereof he requested the sanctification of this soul. He appointed and set apart this child as one who is to be born holy as his precursor and as a witness of his coming into the world, as one who was to prepare the hearts of his people in order that they might recognize and receive him as the Messiah. He ordained that for such an exalted ministry the precursor should receive all the graces, gifts and favors which are befitting and proportionate to his office. All this the Father granted just as the Only Begotten had requested it of him. This happened before the Most Holy Mary had put her salutation into words. At the pronunciation of the words mentioned above, God looked upon the child in the womb of Saint Elizabeth, and gave it perfect use of reason, enlightening it with his divine light, in order that he might prepare himself by foreknowledge for the blessings which he was to receive. Together with this preparation he was sanctified from original sin, made an adopted son of God, and filled with the most abundant graces of the Holy Ghost and with the plenitude of all his gifts. His faculties were sanctified, subjected and subordinated to reason, thus verifying in himself what the Archangel Gabriel had said to Zacharias, that his son would be filled with the Holy Ghost from the womb of his mother. At the same time the fortunate child, looking through the walls of the maternal womb as through clear glass upon the Incarnate Word, and assuming a kneeling posture, adored his Redeemer and Creator, whom he beheld in Most Holy Mary as if enclosed in a chamber made of the purest crystal. This was the movement of jubilation, which was felt by his mother Elizabeth as coming from the infant in her womb. Many other acts of virtue the child John performed during this interview, exercising faith, hope, charity, worship, gratitude, humility, devotion and all the other virtues possible to him there. From that moment he began to merit and grow in sanctity, without ever losing it and without ever ceasing to exercise it with all the vigor of grace. Saint Elizabeth was instructed at the same time in the mystery of the Incarnation, the sanctification of her own son and the sacramental purpose of this new wonder. She also became aware of the virginal purity and of the dignity of the Most Holy Mary. On this occasion, the Heavenly Queen, being absorbed in the vision of the divinity and of the mysteries operated by it through her Most Holy Son, became entirely godlike, filled with the clear light of the divine gifts which she participated. And thus filled with majesty Saint Elizabeth saw her. She saw the Word made man as through a most pure and clear glass in the virginal chamber, lying as it were on a couch of burning and enlivened crystal. The efficacious instrument of all these wonderful effects was the voice of Most Holy Mary, as powerful as it was sweet in the hearing of the Lord. All this force was as it were only an outflow of that which was contained in those powerful words, Fiat mihi secundum verbum tuum, by which she had drawn the eternal Word from the bosom of the Father down to her soul and into her womb. Filled with admiration at what she saw and heard in regard to these divine mysteries, Saint Elizabeth was rapt in the joy of the Holy Ghost. And, looking upon the Queen of the world and what was contained in her, she burst forth in loud voice of praise, pronouncing the words reported to us by Saint Luke, "Blessed art thou among women and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And whence is this to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in my ears, the infant in my womb leaped for joy, and blessed art thou, that has believed, because those things shall be accomplished, that were spoken to thee by the Lord." In these prophetic words Saint Elizabeth rehearsed the noble privileges of Most Holy Mary, perceiving by the divine light what the power of the Lord had done in her, what he now performed, and what he was to accomplish through her in time to come. All this also the child John perceived and understood, while listening to the words of his mother. For she was enlightened for the purpose of his sanctification, and since he could not from his place in the womb bless and thank her by word of mouth, she, both for herself and for her son, extolled the Most Holy Mary as being the instrument of their good fortune. These words of praise, pronounced by Saint Elizabeth, were referred by the Mother of Wisdom and Humility to the Creator. And in the sweetest and softest voice she intoned the Magnificat as recorded by Saint: "My soul doth magnify the Lord. And my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Saviour. Because he hath regarded the humility of his handmaid. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. Because he that is mighty hath done great things to me. And holy is his name. And his mercy is from generation unto generation to them that fear him. He hath showed might in his arm. He hath scattered the proud in the conceit of their heart. He hath put down the mighty from their seat and hath exalted the humble. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent empty away. He hath received Israel, his servant, being mindful of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham and his seed forever." Just as Saint Elizabeth was the first one who heard this sweet canticle from the mouth of Most Holy Mary, so she was also the first one who understood it and, by means of her infused knowledge, commented upon it. She penetrated some of the great mysteries, which its authoress expressed therein in so few sentences. The soul of Most Holy Mary magnified the Lord for the excellence of his infinite essence. To him she referred and yielded all glory and praise both for the beginning and the accomplishment of her works. She knew and confessed that in God alone every creature should glory and rejoice, since he alone is their entire happiness and salvation. She confessed also the equity and magnificence of the Most High in attending to the humble and in conferring upon them his abundant spirit of divine love. She saw how worthy of mortals it is to perceive, understand and ponder the gifts that were conferred on the humility of her, whom all nations were to call blessed, and how all the humble ones, each one according to his degree, could share the same good fortune. By one word also she expressed all the mercies, benefits and blessings, which the Almighty showered upon her in his holy and wonderful name. For she calls them altogether great things, since there was nothing small about anything that referred to this great Queen and Lady. And as the mercies of the Most High overflowed from Mary's plenitude to the whole human race, and as she was the portal of heaven, through which they issued and continue to issue, and through which we are to enter into the participation of the divinity, therefore she confessed that the mercy of the Lord in regard to her is spread out over all the generations, communicating itself to them that fear him. And just as the infinite mercies raise up the humble and seek out those that fear God, so also the powerful arm of divine justice scatters and destroys those who are proud in the mind of their heart, and hurls them from their thrones in order to set in their place the poor and lowly. This justice of the Lord was exercised in wonderful splendor and glory upon the chief of all the proud, Lucifer and his followers, when the almighty arm of God scattered and hurled them, because they themselves precipitated themselves from their exalted seats which befitted their angelic natures and their graces, and which they occupied according to the original decree of the divine love. For by it he intended that all should be blessed while they, in trying to ascend in their vain pride to positions, which they neither could attain nor should aspire to, on the contrary cast themselves from those which they occupied. In their arrogance they were found opposed to the just and inscrutable judgments of the Lord, which scattered and cast down the proud angel and all his followers. In their place were installed the humble of heart through the mediation of Most Holy Mary, the Mother and the treasure house of his ancient mercies. For the same reason this divine lady says and proclaims that God enriches the needy, filling them with the abundance of his treasures of grace and glory. And those that are rich in their own estimation and presumptuous arrogance, and those who satisfy their heart with the false goods, which the world esteems as riches and happiness, the Most High has banished and has banished from his presence, because they are void of the truth, which cannot enter into hearts filled and occupied with falsehood and deceit. He received his servants and his children, the people of Israel, remembering his mercies in order to teach them, wherein prudence, truth and understanding, wherein free and abundant life and nourishment, wherein the light of the eyes and peace consists. He taught them the way of prudence and the hidden paths of wisdom and discipline, which is concealed from the princes of the Gentiles, and is not known to the powerful, who dominate over the beasts of the earth and entertain themselves and play with the birds of the air and heap up treasures of gold and silver. Nor can the sons of Agar and the inhabitants of Tman, who are the wise and the proudly prudent of this world, ever attain this wisdom. But to those that are sons of the light, and who are sons of Abraham by faith, hope and obedience, the Most High distributes it. For in this manner has it been promised to his posterity and his spiritual children, made secure by the blessed and happy fruit of the virginal womb of the Most Holy Mary. Saint Elizabeth, looking upon Mary the Queen of Creation, understood these hidden mysteries. And not only those, which I am able to express here, did this fortunate matron understand, but many more and greater sacraments, which my understanding cannot comprehend. Nor do I wish to dilate upon all that have been shown to me, lest I unduly extend this history. But the sweet discourses and conversations, which these two holy and discreet ladies held with each other, reminded me of the two seraphim, which Isaiah saw above the throne of the Most High, repeating the divine and always new canticle, "Holy, holy," etc., while they covered their head with one pair of wings, their feet with another, flew with the third pair. It is certain that the inflamed love of these two holy women exceeded that of all the seraphim, and Mary by herself loved more than they altogether. They were consumed in the flame of divine love, extending the two wings of their hearts in order to manifest to each other their love and in order to soar into the most exalted intelligence of the mysteries of the Most High. With two more wings of rarest knowledge they covered their faces. Because both of them discussed and contemplated the sacrament of the King, guarding its secrets within themselves all their lives. Also because they restrained their discourse and subjected it to their devoted faith, without giving scope to proud inquisitiveness. They also covered the feet of the Lord and their own with the third pair of seraphic wings, because they were lowered and annihilated in their own humble estimation of themselves at the sight of such great majesty. Moreover, since Most Holy Mary enclosed within her virginal womb the God of Majesty himself, we can with reason and with literal truth say, that she covered the seat where the Lord sat enthroned. When it was time to come forth from their retirement, Saint Elizabeth offered herself and her whole family and all her house for the service of the Queen of Heaven. She asked her to accept, as a quiet retreat, the room which she herself was accustomed to use for her prayers, and which was much retired and accommodated to that purpose. The heavenly princess accepted the chamber with humble thanks, and made use of it for recollecting herself and sleeping therein, and no one ever entered it, except the two cousins. As for the rest, she offered to serve and assist Elizabeth as a handmaid, for she said, that this was the purpose of visiting her and consoling her. Oh, what friendship is so true, so sweet and inseparable, as that which is formed by the great bond of the divine love! How admirable is the Lord in manifesting this great sacrament of the Incarnation to three women before he would make it known to anyone else in the human race! For the first was Saint Anne, as I have said in its place. The second one was her daughter and the mother of the Word, Most Holy Mary. The third one was Saint Elizabeth, and conjointly with her, her son, for he being yet in the womb of his mother, cannot be considered as distinct from her. Thus, the foolishness of God is wiser than men, as Saint Paul says. The Most Holy Mary and Elizabeth came forth from their retirement at nightfall, having passed a long time together. And the Queen saw Zacharias standing before her in his muteness, and she asked him for his blessing as from a priest of the Lord, which the saint also gave to her. Yet, although she tenderly pitied him for his affliction, she did not exert her power to cure him, because she knew the mysterious occasion of his dumbness. Yet she offered a prayer for him. Saint Elizabeth, who already knew the good fortune of the most chaste spouse Joseph, although he himself as yet was not aware of it, entertained and served him with great reverence and highest esteem. After staying 3 days in the house of Zacharias, however, he asked permission of his heavenly spouse Mary to return to Nazareth and leave her in the company of Saint Elizabeth in order to assist her in her pregnancy. The Holy Husband left them with the understanding that he was to return in order to accompany the Queen home as soon as they should give him notice. Saint Elizabeth offered him some presents to take home with him. But he would take only a small part of them, yielding only to their earnest solicitations, for this man of God was not only a lover of poverty, but was possessed of a magnanimous and noble heart. Therewith he pursued his way back to Nazareth, taking along with him the little beast of burden, which they had brought with them. At home, in the absence of his spouse, he was served by a neighboring woman and cousin of his, who, also when Most Holy Mary was at home, was wont to come and go on the necessary errands outside of the house. Amen.